start. There we go. It's not recording our video. So,
on dumb question.
Oh, I was hoping so. I love them. They're much easier to answer. Encryption's too complicated. We're up and going. Okay, this should be working now. We are live. Woohoo! Bob, go ahead.
Well, we all have telephones. Most of us have TVs. And we have internet.
Mm-hmm.
And right now, you can have telephone over the internet.
Okay. Yes.
You can have TV over the internet.
Yes.
Is there any way of having inexpensive internet service? And how do they provide internet service? Like Comcast, Telmex. How does that come about? And is there any, right now, it appears that we have one source. If that source goes out, or they decide that they want to raise the rates, we're all going to be hurting.
Well, what do you mean by one source? Because that's against the way internet works in general. I mean, we really don't have one source.
In rural areas, you pretty much have one source.
Yeah.
If you have Comcast, you don't have another choice. Verizon or whatever.
There's nothing else.
In cities, you have smaller companies that start up. Because there's more
customers.
Well,
yeah.
And
I really thought Bob was talking about this area here. And in this area here, we've got five different sources for internet. It's just we've all narrowed down on the best solution for wherever it is we're located. Telmex ends up being the best solution for you. And I mean, you could use a cell network, but there's bandwidth caps and maybe you don't want to be concerned with running over and paying extra charges, so you've decided not to use the cell network. You've decided to go with Telmex because cable's not available. But maybe
cable won't come in.
Right. Like where I am out in the Ranchitos, they don't have a mega cable. But I could consider cell because 4G is really good out in my area. I just don't want the extra expense. I want to have the unlimited bandwidth cap. And I don't want to deal with the cell's bandwidth cap rules. Like they've got caps on it, like 5 to 10 gigabytes a month, and then you pay extra fees.
One historical note on that: back in the 1980s, there were 2,000 cable companies in the United States, and none of them had the internet.
Right.
Oh,
and now there are about 5, and the internet. They control the internet pretty much.
Right. Well,
so that's a whole different economic thing.
Well, no, you're absolutely right. And
so five, like Verizon, Comcast.
And that's right.
Really, look around. How many big players are there? I mean, yeah. You know, they want to buy each other up, so there's one. So.
Yeah. Same thing in Canada, basically.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, essentially that is what's happened. But in our local area here, we're really talking about the phone company, the cable company, the cell phone company, the...
I don't think you'd have DirecTV, but AT&T just bought them, and they're going to out of the dish business very soon.
A satellite business, or the local Wi-Fi provider, the X-Pro provider.
So not what I was really asking. I was asking, really, is there any alternative?
Yes. Stop communicating.
Huh?
Newspaper.
Stop communicating.
Get a newspaper.
No. I want to communicate. Okay? So, are we...
But you mean an alternative other than those 5 I just mentioned?
Well, I'm thinking about the whole United States, the whole world.
Well, Bob, I guess it's a misunderstanding of what internet is, because the internet at the technology level, the equipment, connecting to equipment, is a series of deals between different networks. So what you're saying, they bought up all these networks. That's not technically how it works. That's how that's how it's played out. But they connect using the same kind of technology that some obscure mom and pop's network would get connected to them. The internet is a bunch of these contracts between networks, allowing data to go to and from and across individual networks, regardless of who owns them. So, let's just use an analogy. Like you're a network, and you've got your customers, and you're over there on that part of the world, and I'm a network, and I've got my customers, and I'm on this part of the world. If my customers want to talk to your customers, I need to set up a deal between you and me so that my traffic will go your direction, and your traffic will go my direction. Now, in a perfect world, let's say Maggie's a network, and she's got customers as well, and she's already got a deal with you. Well, I could do a deal with Maggie, and now my traffic's going through Maggie to get to you, because you have a deal with Maggie. And the only thing that suffers in that is if my traffic overwhelms her connection to you, and she might be like, well, wait, you need to pay a little bit more because I'm monitoring this traffic, and most of your customers are trying to get to Bob. They're not even using my network, so they're just passing through. And this is where that the Netflix and the net neutrality argument comes in. Is it fair? Is it fair that I'm paying this one contract fee over here, and really they're all trying to get over there, and so they're using up this capacity between these two networks? Now, what you could do is you could say, well, I've learned that any traffic that originates at Scott's network that comes through Maggie's network is just overwhelming this connection I have with Maggie. I'm going to start filtering and blocking that network, and I'm going to ask Scott to make a deal with me. So now I would have two different flows of traffic reaching Bob. I'd have one going out through Maggie's network and one going out through Bob's network. Ideally, all the traffic would go through Bob, the network connection we have, because that would be theoretically the best hop of traffic. If it was, because there's an algorithm that happens at a technical level that determines, well, if I go through Maggie's network, I have to make two hops. If I go through Bob's network, I have to make one hop. That's more economical, so that's the direction traffic should flow. But then I would have a backup, because if my link to Bob went down, then traffic could always route to Maggie, and Maggie would route it to Bob. And that's how we get this idea of a web, is we have all these different routes, all these different contracts going on between different networks.
Well, I understand the contracts. This is a little bit like healthcare insurance, where there's some states that only have one provider. And what I'm looking at in the big cities is that there's 10, 15 providers, okay? And in Tucson, there's like three or four, and they're all not very good. And so I'm looking at and saying, does the FCC or whoever maintains this, do they have a lock on states? Or does the state have a lock on who can provide?
Go through Maggie.
I don't know.
Bob will talk after.
Well, there isn't a technical system like that. There isn't something that is. What I'm trying to describe is the openness of the technology. It's one of the reasons that the internet exists in the first place. The reason it was developed by the Department of Defense. Or ARPA originally. The underlying technology is to survive a nuclear attack. It's to be able to communicate from one point to another when a large section of your network has gone down. And it's this rerouting and these connections. And before, I mean, it wasn't really a contract before. You'd have a university call up another university and say, hey, we're going to pay for a DSL connection to your end, would you split the cost with us so your people can reach us? And it just grew out of that. And one of the frustrations in the United States is that the tax breaks that were given to telecommunications companies back in the 90s to lay fiber optics all over the United States. We had all this fiber. Those companies did it, like WorldCom, they had lost their shirts because they were doing these shady businesses, and all this fiber was up for grabs at reasonable prices, and they've ended up under one company. And so you can technically take out one company and affect most of the internet traffic, not only in the United States, but across the world. It's not the way it was intended to be. It's because of the way It's the way they tried to promote competition and promote growth in internet that it's ended up like this.
See, I'm looking at it from the point of view, I decided never to have everything banded together. What do they call it?
Bundle.
Bundle. And because we got to Tucson and the internet went out, and all of a sudden we didn't have phone. Mm. We couldn't make a phone call, we didn't have TV, we didn't have anything because it was all bundled. So I said, okay, from now on, we'll have some separate contracts. And I wonder why I can't buy internet service from Dallas or Shaw from Canada.
I hear the analogy now with it. I understand now your healthcare analogy. I've been surprised following this news how they're talking about out of network coverage, because when I went to go price Obamacare, I need to start calling it ACA when it first became available, and this is not a computer topic, so I'm sorry we've gotten off on this, but to bring the analogy back, I could buy insurance for my family in Arizona for $300 a month with ACA. I go up to Alaska to buy it and it's $650 a month. And I'm like, wait a second, are you telling me that if I got sick in Alaska with Arizona insurance, somebody wouldn't cover me? Well, apparently from following it recently, that's exactly what they're saying.
Oh my.
I didn't realize that. I didn't realize that I could have private insurance that they wouldn't respect in another state.
I don't think that's true.
Well, that's, if that's not true, I hope it's not true, but that's what media is covering right now.
Mm-hmm. In Medicare, I have a supplement that is not good a lot of places.
Well, yeah.
You're on an advantage plan.
Yeah, it depends which one, I
think.
Yeah. If you're on mutual,
let's get back to the internet.
I mean, it's everywhere.
We know there's problems with healthcare.
Well, I mean, this is a fun, discussion. But I do have some topics if people are interested. I have come with some information that I thought would be really interesting to share. Let me bring it up in front of me.
Mm-hmm. I still have a quick question on the topic there, if you can. And that's on the, I'm seeing the ads right now for the satellite internet, and I'm wondering if anybody's tried it out, how good
use
it is.
Net. Use net.
Is anybody used satellite internet? I haven't used it since way back in the day when we didn't have DSLs here.
DirecTV is satellite.
You're talking about Tom.
And we have.
We're talking about. This,
we have that footprint right here.
Okay.
Yeah,
DirecTV is
only
down.
And they've gone away. Now they're internet. Now they're not using the satellite. What are they using? They're using internet TV, right?
Well, what they're doing is they're not providing or they're switching to a model where they're more like a Netflix, where they're doing their TV streaming through an internet connection,
right?
Instead of being the provider of the stream or being the provider of the
they want to finish that by 2020,
and that's because of AT&T buying them out.
Yeah, but we have friends that are on HughesNet in New Mexico because they're out in the sticks.
Right.
And they don't have a choice if they want internet. They've got to go through the satellite.
Is it working pretty good for them?
Yeah, it seems to be.
They're happy with it.
Better than their cell phone service.
And so is that over the whole continent or just a continental U.S. or anybody know?
Well, I know it works here because I have a friend of mine. In fact, we had dinner with him last night and he has a ranch towards Padre Aquino. And everything for him is off satellite.
Right. Okay.
And it, he said it really works. A little expensive, but if you have no phone and no internet service, it's a little difficult to talk to him sometimes because you have a. You'll say, "How are you doing?" He'll say,
wait,
"What?
Wait,
what?
Wait.
Fine."
Oh,
yeah. Little
oh, there'll be a pause.
Yes.
Delay.
Yeah.
Okay. Is that Jim you're talking about?
Yes.
Over. Okay. Thank you.
I'm sorry. I'm fighting with our internet connection right now. And so I'm waiting for my list of stuff to come up here. I'm losing. I don't know who's winning, but I'm definitely losing. Come on.
It appears to me that a lot of the problems are because we have monopolies.
There we go.
Oh.
I can tell you in Denver, we asked about it, and they actually have a contract with the city of Denver, and we can't get additional service to our neighborhood. And we don't even have high-speed internet access at our, we don't have broadband, we have 7 megabit, and we asked to get more, and they're like, it's not in the contract, they have to provide more with the city of Denver.
That's in the federal law that was passed in the 70s, that there's only about 3 cities in the country that have more than one. Somerville, Mass. Built their own cable system to compete with whoever wanted to get in there. And they've had this for 20-something years. But when you go through the process, which I did for our town, you have to prove without a doubt they've been terrible the last 10 years, and so they cannot renew. Mm-hmm. At that point, it's just a question of arguing with them and negotiating with them about rate increases and how much the office is going to be open and this and that and the other thing. But they're locked in. Which is why they're buying each other up, because back in the 80s, each customer was worth about $2,000. So imagine what it's worth now.
Wow. Okay. I have brought some topics I thought were going to be interesting. I think one of the ones that's big on people's minds, if you're not paying attention to it, is the CIA dump of documents.
Yep.
But I thought we might start out with, I read a great review, compare and contrast on laptop support, that I thought people that might be in the market for new laptops, new computers might be interested in. I'll give you the synopsis of it. They went through a number of different vendors and they made a table of where they got the best support for problems. And the very best is Apple, which is no surprise at all.
Yay.
But number two is a big surprise. It was Acer, which is notoriously one of the worst computer manufacturers on the planet. Apparently has some of the best technical support on the phone, on the website, under chat, under email. They are number two right now on this list of vendors. The other thing that came as a shock to me is Asus, the manufacturer of my laptop, and Samsung, the manufacturer of the exploding phone, are on the worst.
Oh.
The worst three in order, from least worst to worst, is Asus, Samsung, and then MSI. And if you're from Canada, you're probably very familiar with MSI. That's another brand name that gets distributed around a lot. Asus and MSI are awesome developers of technology. So it doesn't surprise me that they would be down on the support. They come out of hardware. They don't come out of consumer electronics. I'm really surprised that Samsung would be down on that list, because Apple has turned themselves into a consumer-facing computer company. They are a consumer electronics company. That's why it's just not surprising that they would have such good customer support.
Is Lenovo on that list at all?
I think it is. I'll put the link on the website so you can check it out. It's a large list of manufacturers, and they had a criteria that they went through of how they would rate, and everybody got a rating from 1 to 5 on certain things, like how long did it take to get a hold of somebody that could help you, how hard was it to find support by phone, by web, wait times for things like chat, things like that. And they put together an algorithm and then compared it across the board.
Well, that was in the Consumer Guide about a month ago, in the last issue or 2 months ago. I read that same article.
Yeah? Yeah, did you find it helpful? Did you see your company on it?
Yeah.
Well, sometimes you might have a comparison that the company makes really good equipment.
Right.
Then they don't rely on a lot of support because it's not necessary. Whereas if they have a lot of problems, then they're going to have a lot of support too.
Well, and you definitely, that was always my war cry with HP as it got worse and worse in quality. At the very least, their customer support got better and better and easier to use. I'm always one of those, I don't think we should be on the phone with support. I think it should just work. A little different with Apple is very patient with things like, I don't know how to use iMovie, right? And like Asus would never spend any time helping me edit, you know, right? It's like, what, the screen works, keyboard works, battery works, why are you calling is more the experience I expect from Asus. But in Asus's defense, with this laptop particularly, I think I mentioned before I had an experience when I first got it, where about three different occasions, I went to my backpack, I opened it up, and it's hot.
Uh-oh.
And I find that the laptop is on. And in tech circles, that's a very common problem. It's called hot bag. And so I immediately reported it through Asus. I think I used email support. Yeah, I used email support. And I got an answer back within about 12 hours saying, what's that? Take it out of the backpack? Yeah. Well, the hot bag problem is also if it's really hot, you probably have a dead battery by that point because it's been running ever since you stuck it in the bag. And they had an immediate suggestion. They knew exactly what the problem was. They asked me to download and reinstall a driver. They gave me the link, and it was as easy as... I mean, whenever I get into these, I try not to be a technician when I get into these situations. I want to have the experience that you guys are having because I want to know what prompted somebody to call me to come deal with it. Right. And it was very good. They sent me an email. It had a link in it. If you're going to click on a link in email, you better be expecting to get a link. Don't do it randomly. And I've been well trained by the computer club. I don't click on links unless I'm expecting them. And so I clicked on the link. It downloaded the software. I just ran it like I would any other download that came. Restarted the computer. The problem's been gone ever since. Unfortunately, that means that the preloaded software had an issue, and it was resolved by reinstalling something it could have came with originally. Mm-hmm. But it was resolved very quickly and easily. And Asus's customer support dealt with it as efficiently as I'd expect any customer to deal with it, or any support to deal with it. On that note, I had to call Telmex this morning. I'm sitting there getting ready for Computer Club, and I'm doing research, and my wife's watching some news on YouTube on our big screen TV, and all of a sudden, no internet. It's just gone. And we're connected to the Wi-Fi, but there's no internet. And I look over at the modem across the room, and the light's gone. I'm like, oh, great. What's going on now? First thing I do is I reboot the modem. I wait for it to come up. I watch the DSL light flashing, trying to make its connection. It never connects. And so I have to call Telmex and report this as a problem. And they want me to go through all the steps, right? And it's like, and they're not hearing me say, it was just working. It was working at its maximum potential it's ever been able to work at. And now it's gone. It's gone like somebody yanked a cable out of it. And finally, I mean, after filling out all the, you know, he's got to check all these boxes and fill out all these, he gave me a report number, and it will be dealt with within 3 to 5 days, he told me.
Yeah.
That was the first time I heard the five-day thing. I'm like, no. He's like, well, really, it's probably going to get handled sooner.
When a sweat day.
Yeah, and I hung up, and immediately, internet was back. So internet was gone through a 15-minute conversation because I called him almost immediately after it happened, and then it was back after the conversation.
Who did you call that actually answered?
The 800 number. Oh, and I deal with them in Spanish, too. I don't even try to deal with them in English.
Our phone went out.
This internet here is going on and off, on and off, mm-hmm. on and off.
Our phone went out Monday afternoon, but the internet stayed on. The internet went out Tuesday afternoon, and it wasn't until Friday afternoon that they came out and fixed it.
There isn't a better example of how this DSL technology is such a different technology than your phone technology than that. Those two signals, those two services are flowing down the same piece of copper, and you can have instances where your internet goes out and your phone works just fine. That's what I was having this morning. Or you can have instances where the phone goes out and the internet's working just fine.
And I was in communication. Somebody was texting me in perfect English.
Oh, texting you.
Texting me. And we will be there today. This was Tuesday, started at 8 o'clock in the morning. And at 4 to 5, you said, my boss won't let me come. And it's a long story. We had some issues going on. And I wrote back and told him why it was important that we have this. And he said, I'll see what I can do. And I never heard from them again. I went down to the office Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. Again, Friday morning. They told me no one was back there. They couldn't help me. I saw the truck. So I went back where the technicians are, where it says authorized personnel only, and walked right in. And
well, you were
about
authorized.
Half an hour later, the guy showed up to fix my phone.
That's great.
Yeah.
What's this?
Yeah. We're in a little community of about 20 homes, and we're just off Main Street. We're talking about investing in underground infrastructure to bring a better service in. And we can get it above line to the start of our property. And then we'd have to dig and put pipes in around the property to get it ready so they can hook up. Is there a person at Telmex that I can talk to? I kind of doubt it here. Does anybody know anybody in Wyoming that you can talk to help you, that can answer questions about how to do this and if we should do this? Anybody know anybody down there? Okay.
Offhand,
I'll let you know.
Yeah, offhand, I would think just starting out with a Bell. He's really approachable. He's the young guy that.
Yeah, I know who he is. Yeah.
I mean, I would start my questions with him because he's. Yeah. I love when he does work. He does things like follows up with you. Yeah.
Carlos
is very good.
Who came
too.
To mine Friday, my house Friday. He speaks a lot of English, and he was very efficient. He told me everything that was wrong and how he was going to fix it.
Yeah. And then when it starts working again, you'll end up with a phone call later, and you'll be like, so it's all working okay, right?
Yes.
You've done a speed test. You're happy with everything that's happened. I mean, he really knows what
he's
doing.
I used to get along with him real well until one day I couldn't get a hold of him. I walked in the back through that door and says, no admittance. And then I met he's never spoken to me since.
That's
true.
Don't listen to him.
That was about 3 years ago.
He gave me his cell phone number. So if I had a problem, just
doesn't
call him on
the cell
phone.
Doesn't work anymore, though.
He gave me, well, this was a month ago.
Oh, so you have a new number. Because my number doesn't work anymore that I have.
Yeah. Fiber optic cable, where you are now. What's going to replace fiber optic cable? Is it all going
to Nothing be? Soon. It's the most amazing technology we have for cable infrastructure.
So why?
Yeah, I mean, they're talking about... You can get 1 gigabyte connections across fiber optic right now, and they're about to move up to 10 gigabits a second, and they're talking about 100 gigabits a second. So there's no reason. They right now, from our perspective, that looks like an infinite capacity. It's all about how creative they are with the technology. Well, and even the DSLs are just mind-boggling. When ADSL came on the scene around here, couldn't imagine more than 3 megabits a second. There was a hard limit in the States at 6 megabits a second. And now they've tweaked that, and Jim's getting 20 megabits a second just off of his post running standard copper twisted pair on a DSL connection. It's just...
Well, I'm a block off the fiber, though.
Right. But the fact that you could pump that across that piece of copper gives you an idea of how infinite the copper is in the fiber optic is so much more. There's so much more possible capabilities there. Did you have a question over there?
Yeah, just along the lines of Maggie, I had the same problem with my phone and internet. Hi, Maggie. And I went in there, asked to get it fixed, and looking at this piece of paper, they have a promotion on right now, and I went from 10 megabytes to 20 for the same price for a 3-month trial period. Shangri-La.
Is it working, Bob?
And I get 20.
You're getting 20 in Shangri-La? Really?
So for 389 pesos, I get a phone and 20. And it actually works.
Wow.
Well, that's
for 3 months.
We don't get that in
promotion. I should have asked if there was a promotion on the big
fiber
one.
No.
Well, there's fiber optics going down First Street. That's how Jim gets his. But I'm far enough away from it, they can't guarantee more than a 10 megabit connection, and it normally maxes out around 8-9 megabits a second.
It ends on G.
Yeah.
And Loma Del Mar will never have it.
Not without some really retooling in that area.
Never.
I read an article where Telmex, one of their engineers, came out with a way of really improving the speed with through copper. It was quite a technology. I wish they'd put it in the U.S.
Hey, I am working down a list of topics here with a goal. Did you guys hear about the 38 Android phones that were purchased by two specific companies that have been left unnamed in the media that were discovered later to have arrived new with malware on them? This is pretty significant, because what they're identifying is that these phones left manufacturer clean and showed up dirty. And somewhere in the supply chain, they were infected with malware. And the malware is serious malware. They say that of the malware that was discovered, there's malware there to steal personal information. There's malware there to throw advertising up on your phone. And they even found a copy of Slocker, which I wasn't that aware of by that name, but it's a ransomware app. So it's one that can encrypt the entire phone and then send you a message going, if you want all this information back, send 2 bitcoins to such and such address to get your phone back. These are corporate phones. This is a slew of phones sent out to a corporation, bought in bulk. The most frustrating thing about these is that all these things were installed at a system administrator level, which most normal people don't have access to, which also means you probably couldn't have solved this problem or recognized this problem as a normal person. Even if you recognized it, you'd still have to have administrative rights on your phone, which most normal people don't. You haven't jailbroke your phone to get rid of the problem. And if your phone arrived like this, you wouldn't even notice a difference in performance, because your phone would have always behaved like this from day one.
Right.
So there wouldn't be any indicator that there was something fishy going on in the background. This is just the way the phone works. And it really brings into question any possible discount phone you might be buying. You know, there's these places that buy up traded in phones and sell them off, and they refurbish them. Supposedly a lot of these are legitimate. I'm assuming that's what these companies were using, was some legitimate third party. They're not Samsung, they're not AT&T, they're some third party that bought up the phones that were being brought back so that their customers could buy new phones at a discount. And then they've taken those phones, they verified that they work still, they got good batteries, they cleaned them off, and then they've sent them back. So supposedly that's where these kinds of phones may have ended up. And now that I say that, I'm wrong, because this article was referring specifically to brand new phones. So
somewhere in the chain
yeah. They ended up infected.
So how would they determine 38 or 30 some phones? How would they?
It's a security group. What's the name of them? I don't have
a security
checkpoint.
Security group.
That's pretty.
Actually, what I'm saying is they found 36 phones.
Maybe more.
Yeah, they found 36 phones associated with two companies that made bulk purchases. They were all infected with the same. Yeah, you're right. It could be more. It could be your phone. And what I did was I mixed two topics right there. The only recommendation, there was no recommendation how to identify this. They're still trying to sort out how to deal with this kind of problem. But the recommendations from the security firm were, be careful when you buy from third party parties instead of directly buying, because that they could be doing this kind of stuff. That was not what happened here. This is the only advice they have, is the only thing you can do is be wary of these kinds of problems. You probably don't want to buy from a questionable third party, because there's less chance something like this could happen. Saying that there's a higher chance that this kind of thing would happen from a third party, even though that's not the case here. This was something in the supply chain.
Mm-hmm. Who's the they that will spend time and effort to determine that first of all this occurred and then correct it otherwise?
Yeah, it's a very good question. In this case, it was security analysts for the companies that bought it, brought it to their attention. This checkpoint that has done done the review on this, they're one of those companies that you hire to monitor your network traffic as a corporation and let you know. I actually just recently had an experience with this for one of the companies that I work with. We get this email, phone call email, all follow up, that one of our computers is infected with a brand new style of malware that our antivirus is not finding. Yeah, and they're able to recognize it because they see it flowing out of our network, because they're hired to monitor our network traffic. So I speculate that's what Checkpoint was doing, is they were doing that for these two companies and discovered this malware, tracked it down to the phones that were just recently purchased. Gary, I don't know how to do it for your phone, right? And if I got a great deal on a phone on Amazon, maybe that's a dangerous thing. Maybe that's something that's happening now, is that these phones are compromised before they get sent out to you. And if they happen at the ROM level, there's no way for you to know any difference. That's the way the phone came. That's the way you've always known the phone to work. We've already had one other experience. No, we've had more than one, but we have one other famous experience with a blue phone offered by Amazon for discount because it shoots advertisement at you. It's a phone that would normally cost $150 is available for $99 from Blue, as long as you get the Amazon special deal. And what on your lock screen, Amazon just pops up advertising trying to get you to buy from them. Well, it turns out the third party that developed that ROM for that phone was collecting all the information from that phone. It was phoning home with all your activities, and those activities were being gathered in a database that could be sold later or used for cross-marketing. So that's a famous story that's less than a year old that's happened. And that was Amazon vetting a phone for their customers, discovering later it wasn't Blue, it wasn't Amazon, it was this third party that was used to build the Amazon fork of this software. And they did it on purpose. It wasn't an accident that they were collecting this information. It was one of those, we'll ask for forgiveness later.
Well, you've said for many years, you said there is no such thing as security. Okay? Well, and we understand that, but the trick is not to get paranoid, because 99% of the people out there think that everything is clean, everything is safe. We got all this, you know.
Well, it is interesting, and this Vault 7 stuff is really interesting if you guys aren't paying attention to it. Let me hit some quick highlights on this. Vault 7 is this mass dump of CIA leaks that has just hit us, and the stories will be coming out of this for months, years, very similar to the original Snowden dump. Mm-hmm. They're still finding out more and more stuff that was going on. But some of the key aspects I thought that everyone should know about is, one of the biggest points in this dump is the CIA lost all their exploits. So everything that I'm about to tell you about, all the tools the CIA have been using for monitoring people, and most of Vault 7 is about monitoring specific devices. So Snowden was all about mass data collection across networks. Right. This is about micro data collection on individual devices. And they lost their stockpile, their armory of these kinds of exploits. The CIA was hacked. All their exploits have been grabbed. And now there are entities out on the internet that have the hacking capacity of the CIA. Right? That's one of the biggest things that's come out of this. Another thing that came out of this is they're saying that this Frankfurt base, that's U.S. consulate in Frankfurt, Germany, is actually a CIA covert hacker base. And the reason they've picked this is because they can give them diplomatic status, get them into Germany, and then from there they have access to 25 neighboring countries that don't require any kind of identification. They can come and go. They can plug in their resources in any of those countries to monitor that information.
They don't know yet if this was internal or external, right?
where the dump came from? I haven't seen anything so far that shows where it's come from. We also learned that the CIA maintains a library of stolen exploits. And this is very interesting, because the CIA can actually, with this, they can go in and hack a specific country, making it look like it was another country hacking them. So you can do things like hack the U.S. election and make it look like the Russians did it. Just to bring it up to speed with what's going on in our world.
Jeez, all I want to do is connect my photos on all devices.
Can you think of anything more frustrating than you can't get your password right, but the NSA seeing you in your underwear?
Yeah, yeah.
Well, there's people that use their password. There's people in the United States that use password, and their password is called password. That's how stupid they are.
That's right.
Yeah. Or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
Yeah. Well, this is really overt inception of devices that are connected to the internet. And the most overt, I think, is this Weeping Angel exploit that has come to light. This is a way that they can turn Samsung TVs into covert microphones.
Mm.
And I still haven't gotten a clarification on whether this means every Samsung smart TV. My Samsung doesn't have a microphone, or I don't know of it having a microphone. It doesn't have a web camera, or I don't know of it having a web camera. But what I do know from programmable controllers is that an input can be an output, or an output can be an input, based on how you write the software from a programmable controller. And I also know from electrical engineering that a speaker and a microphone, it's a very thin line between what a speaker is and what a microphone is. And if you combine these two topics, then it would only require a little bit of hacking to turn the speaker on any smart TV into a microphone. Which means this could be even worse than you could imagine. Not to throw fear out there. I want an answer to this question. I want to know if that's actually what has happened here. And it doesn't matter whether you bought your computer or you bought your Samsung TV with a microphone or a webcam with it, that you're still at risk because it's a smart TV, a programmable controller, they're suave enough to be able to change the input direction. They're definitely smart enough to make the TV look like it's turned off. That's the idea of the covert microphone, is that they're able to turn on the microphone and your TV's sitting there in the off position. And those conversations are just getting warehoused at a covert CIA server. The last thing that I wanted to point out.
Is it the same with the things you talked to on your table?
Oh yeah, absolutely. Yeah, that's NSA, FBI. That's happening right now. But you can bet the CIA doesn't have to hack an Echo. You have hacked yourself with it.
Okay.
Yeah. You have made it clear that you're not worried about personal privacy by putting that into your life. The last thing that really bothers me as a technician is that it is documented that the CIA is hoarding exploits that they could be informing the industry about. That when they find a hack on an Apple device or a Samsung device, they are not sharing that information with the company, and they are leaving the rest of us at risk.
Yeah.
And that's what really bothers me, is that they should have a civil responsibility to provide that information to manufacturers so that everything is getting tightened up and secured. I understand their need to have information, have covert information, but we as a people shouldn't be supporting an agency that would leave us out there hanging.
Yeah.
So it's, whose fault is it that I had my ID stolen, really? I mean, if the CIA is scared to talk about the iPhone hack for fear that it's going to close their hole and it leaves me exposed, who's really liable for that issue?
So what's the answer?
Well, I don't know. We're watching it all blow up in our face right now. I'm really curious how it plays out. I mean, how do you feel, Bob? Do you feel like You feel like the CIA should be held liable for leaving a security hole open on you?
Jail all the techs.
Hey, I didn't do any of this. I didn't do any of this. This was not me.
That's what all criminals say. I didn't do it. Right?
I actually had one student say he was guilty.
One out of how many?
And guess what? He wasn't.
He wasn't?
And he wasn't.
Let loose. Yeah.
This works. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I think the solution starts with all of us being aware of what's going on.
Yeah.
Hey, this is the world we're living in now. This is equal to the Snowden revelations. It's at a different area than the Snowden revelations were. Between what the NSA was doing with mass data collection and what the CIA is doing with device compromising, it really is 1984. It really is. We are living in this world where all this stuff is reported. Everything you're doing is being accumulated. All there needs to be is just a reason to go look up your name and they can see everything you've been doing.
But you become paranoid. So what's the answer?
San Carlos
probably.
Beach lifestyle.
Yeah.
Turn to religion.
What if you turn your
I like the carrier pigeon suggestion.
And they take it off.
When it's off,
you'd have to unplug
it. What if you covered it with some bubble wrap or aluminum?
You have doors installed. They're into the cabinet. And you have doors.
I think we're all going to wear those helmets.
What about
Yeah. Well, you know, that's going to be the next revelation, is that aluminum foil caps actually do work to prevent your brain waves from being picked up by government apparatuses. I can't wait for that document disclosure. It will probably come from the White House in the form of a tweet.
From Trump.
Did you read the Mexican news? How Mexico is.
Go ahead, Paul. I'm sorry.
Is going to petition the U.S. to get some of their land back, like California, Nevada, Arizona. But they realize that won't happen, so they're going to ask for compensation. But they did find one area, I'm not sure where it is, probably Arizona, where when the war between Mexico and the U.S. was settled, they put all the markers out. They said, okay, this is Mexico, this is United States. Of course, what the gringos did is, oh, there's a lot of land over there. So they moved the line, and they have it legal, and they want the president of Mexico to raise hell.
Just read about
Wow.
So if you live in southern Arizona, you may become
Colorado.
Mexico. You might become
Colorado.
Mexico.
Yeah. As far as
you gotta move the wall.
Yeah.
Back to the security thing.
Sure.
I think each decade younger you go from our age down, there's less and less concern.
I agree. You know what? I kind of feel like this is technology. This is what's happening.
Yeah.
We are destined to be an open information society, and there is no closing that door. I mean, outside of nuclear holocaust, I don't see that ever changing. This fear right now, the concern is the oversight, because it is not to the benefit of us individually. And that's where, in my opinion, things have to change. I really don't care if you can see everything that I've done on the internet. I'll just live with it. I'm not doing anything I'm really that concerned about. But I would sure like to know what my politicians are doing. So why isn't that information made available to me the same way my information is being made available to them?
Yeah, exactly.
And I think it's going to be a force of people saying, no, we don't care that you're collecting it all. It has to. And I've preached this for a long time. Listen to this idea. I think that we should be offered free backups from the NSA. I think that when your computer fails, I should be able to petition the NSA to give me a copy of my information.
Yeah.
And I think that if the NSA, I think the NSA could sell it. I think they could be like, we're collecting everybody's information, but you know what you've got? You've got a real-time cloud backup all the time. Right?
They should provide the phones, too.
Sure, yeah, that's right. Why am I having to pay for these cell phones when all you use it for is a microphone? You should give me the phone.
Mm-hmm. Let me help you provide you.
Not without the fourth estate being an honest broker, there is no end. Because if the press is not an honest broker in this, and they're not, then they're there has to be an outside source that looks at all aspects and at least exposes those.
Yeah.
It's not happening, it's not gonna happen.
I don't pretend to have the answers in this respect. What I do know for a fact is technology is amoral. Technology for technology's sake, that's all that exists. And how it gets used is up to the people that deem behavior to be correct or not.
But how it's exposed also is that the NSA is not going to expose it. CIA is not going to expose it. And the Fourth Estate is not going to expose it in an unbiased manner.
Right.
Yeah. And that's how we end up with WikiLeaks, right? I mean, that's like Star Wars. The more you tighten your grip, the more they'll slip through your fingers.
No, that's how we ended up with Donald Trump.
Television last night, exactly. On the news. First time I watched news in about 10 days or 2 weeks.
Hey, keep in mind, they were watching you, too.
But what it was, they had at least 25 Americans, and I think it all happened in eastern Canada, and they left the U.S., been in Canada for however long, and we're coming back in, whether it be a weekend or 2 weeks or whatever, we're coming back in, and when they got to the American border to check in, customs demanded their cell phones and computers and their passports.
Oh, I did see that, yes.
Yeah. And they had to give them up, and the one guy, it was the second time it happened to him in a two-week period, and the second time, like when he got home the first time, they just turned him over, and he and his wife, they didn't think they did think about it, but they turned it over, and they had nothing to hide, and he went home, and he thought about it, and he thought, you know, this isn't right, this is, like, without a warrant,
yeah,
and with no cause.
Imported to the U.S., they were born in the United States.
They were,
yeah.
But in all cases, they were second and third generation, yeah. Mideastern. They all had Mideastern appearance.
I was second origin.
But they were U.S. citizens.
So the second time he went through, they asked again, and he said, no, this isn't right. You can't do that.
Right.
And they actually tackled him, and the one guy grabbed him by the throat and stuff, and they took his phone away from him. And his wife jumped back, and she just gave her phone.
Yeah.
But they actually physically accosted him.
Well, how about all these kids have been stopped twice in airports in the last 3 weeks?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Oh, really?
Yeah. Well,
but that's how ridiculous we are at this point.
But he didn't want to give up his passport. He didn't want to show identification. That was in the news, too. He refused to give him any identification. Yes, that's why.
I'll check that out.
Yes.
Yeah, that's the first time I had heard that about Ali Jr. story.
I did read about that.
I don't know, but the refusing the phone, I definitely heard about that, and I was really surprised by the reaction. I could see them holding you up for hours because you refused to give them the phone. Along with that article was this incredible spike in, they're reporting on this incredible spike in asking for digital devices and having digital devices searched just in this last year. I don't know about in the last couple of weeks, but in the last year, there's been like 1,000% increase in asking to search digital devices.
It turns out it's legal for them to demand your phone.
Yeah, it's been legal for years now for them to demand the phone.
They've never done it.
They researched it, and they said it actually goes back to sub-amendment or whatever in 1886 or something. So that particular amendment to the Constitution, protecting civil rights and privacy, has actually, since 1886, has never applied to the borders. So if you come across the border, coming into the country, it's never applied in the first place. So.
But it's there.
Yeah,
they can
do it. They
right.
Are within the rights to
plan your phone. Technology, we oftentimes think that the United States is the best in the world.
See, guys.
Is the best in the world for technology. Is that really true? Or where is the technological
Technological center
technological,
of the world.
Thank you. Where is the technological empire in the world?
Silicon Valley.
Is it the United States? Or is it Japan? Taiwan?
Yeah, Korea? Where, you know, Samsung is South Korea.
I know.
Yeah. Japan is has been in the past.
I mean, you see Mexicans run around with, everybody's got a cell phone.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you go to Europe.
Yeah.
Everybody's got a cell phone.
Mm-hmm, sure, yeah.
My daughter's in India today, and we were talking with her this morning.
Boy, India's, I mean, for years been a tech central area, very sophisticated people, tech suave. That's why we had so many tech jobs outsourced and so many techs from there come over to the United States to do work. They have a huge population of highly educated people.
So you really don't know where the, there's got to be some place that's really prominent.
The brain. Where's the brain?
I don't know.
Well, even Russia has highly educated hackers. I have always laughed at the Russians hacking the election idea because Russians hack everything. Yeah. I mean, we hack everything, but Russia has some of the most sophisticated hackers. It's hard to attribute that to an agenda. That's just what they do. They just hack everything.
It's a way of life.
It's hard to I mean, like, they would have to, what we're arguing about is whether they had an influence on Trump winning the election.
Right. Yeah.
I have trouble believing that, but I don't have any problems believing they were involved in hacking in our election. Sure. That's just what they do. They hack everything.
Yeah. And so, as you said, so do we.
Right, and so do we. I mean, why would we expect any? The reason that people are so burned is because they know exactly what we're capable of doing. So
that's where the fourth estate again is dishonest, because instead of discussing that, it goes down a certain direction. It makes the population feel like, oh my goodness, this is horrible here.
Yeah, fear.
I think that's one of the biggest problems we have, is that we don't educate people and analyze where the information is coming from.
Mm-hmm.
And to actually understand that wherever it's coming from, they all have their own philosophy and agenda.
Mm-hmm.
And that influences what they're saying.
Absolutely.
And I don't think the younger generation especially is aware of that at all. I really don't.
Well,
when I was growing up, they taught you that this newspaper and this thing, this is their agenda. And you understood when you read something that it was influenced by this particular philosophy.
They used to be called the Topeka Democrat or the Oklahoma Republic.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, right. Pretty obvious.
Yeah.
But
what you're talking about is like a media deconstruction, like the ability to look at something and recognize not only the content but the sources and who's behind it.
And look beyond the headline, because the headline may be different than what the body is.
Yeah.
Well, it's like statistical research too.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You can make that tell whatever you want it to tell. And if you don't read that and understand that, then
it's like
you're subject to being influenced.
You almost have to read the entire article, even though it's not that interesting. An incident in New Mexico, there was a mother and her son were murdered on the bridge of the Americas going from El Paso into Juarez, and driving an expensive Mercedes, and this lovely, flawless couple. You read the whole thing till you get to the last part, where it says they lived in Mexico and they're in Juarez, and they were part of the cartel.
Right.
But if you just read the first paragraph, these poor, innocent Americans were murdered.
Yeah.
Right here.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Well, they like to slant. I wonder why our newspaper at home is called the Press Democrat.
Press Democrat.
I wonder.
You know that speaker last night?
Mm-hmm.
When Don and I got there early, and I was talking with him. He told me last night that he was going to travel with his lady friend up to Alaska, because I told him that's where I'm from. So they got to the Canadian border, and they wouldn't let him in Canada. because he'd had a DUI 50 years ago.
Oh, really?
Because why?
Wait, DUI in Canada? DUI,
no, in the U.S.
In the United States.
He'd had a DUI.
Wow.
No, it was in Canada.
It was in Canada.
I guess. Yeah. I guess that's what it was.
Because, like, why would they care in the States?
50 years ago.
But he's a professor, and he goes up to Canada several times.
So they wouldn't let him drive in Canada.
He couldn't drive.
No. So he figures, well, the only way he's going to get up to Alaska is got to fly or take a boat. And he didn't want to do either because he's a camper.
Well, you could take the ferry. I mean, I know it's a completely different discussion. The ridiculousness, you're scary.
$6,000 round trip.
Seven.
Seven, is that what he said?
Seven.
But they also asked for
the ferry?
DUI.
But the ferry was how many long days or something?
So you lie?
I got issues with this thing.
Okay, let me shut us down because we're a bit over time. I just want to give a taste for next week. I recently set up IPTV on my Samsung, so that means the CIA knows. And there, I was able to stick a web address into the IPTV software that came with the Samsung TV or the Samsung app that I'm using, and was able to get a huge list of American programs available for streaming live TV.
Why wasn't here last week? Are you talking about Cody?
All new to me. Maybe Jim's got some experience with it. It all spun out of a Cody discussion I was having with a buddy of mine, a Mexican that lives in Guaymas. He was learning about Cody at the same time I was, and he was turning me on to this SSIPTV, which is an application you can download from the Samsung store. Have you heard of it, Jim?
No, I don't have Samsung.
Okay, well, IPTV, I think an IPTV piece of software, one that can read playlists. Then you go find a playlist, went out to this website called exabyte.info, and they had playlists of basically lists of channels of live TV streaming for different geographical locations. It looks like it's maintained at least by Latinos, maybe specifically Mexico, because it had very specific lists for Mexicans inside and outside the United States, and it had lists for the United States, UK, and Canada of what you'd find as standard channels. I mean, essentially felt very similar to like a mock TV kind of experience, but through the internet, through my TV set.
Are you going to talk about all this next week?
Yeah, I'm going to bring it up next week.
Okay.
What was the website?
exabyte.info. exabyte.tv.info.
Thank you.
I have a question. Is there a place in town where you can go and use a telephone for a long distance call?
You can come over to my office if you want. We've got, there's a lot of folks here that have internet phones.
I know, but I don't want to impose on private. I just thought if there's a place like a phone booth.
Where do you live?
Where do I live?
Yeah, in this area. I mean, I have Magic Jack.
Well, that's what I'm looking for.
Yeah.
So
yes.
I'm house sitting out in the golf course right now.
Oh.
In the Royal.
And you know, so many of the cell phones now have unlimited calling to the United States.
Yeah, but it tells me something in Spanish, and I don't know what she's saying to me.
This is interesting.
If you've got a smartphone, you could always load up something like Skype or a tablet. Okay. Well, yeah.
I just want to find I was thinking Expo here, but they're not open.
Okay. Well, we've got a Magic Jack sitting there in the office we use for that kind of stuff. You're welcome to come by and use it.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Magic Jack.
Yes, that's what I was looking for, but I've got to find one.
Magic Jack will work for you as long as you're not calling Alaska.
It works.
Oh, does it work now?
No. Here's the trick. I called the technician. I said, "What is this?" He said, "Because I have a friend. In fact, we've been at Alamos together for 3 days." She said, "I won't have Magic Jack. My son's in Alaska. I can't get him." I said, "Yes, you can." She said, "What is it?" I said, "Well, they come on and tell you that you can't get Magic Jack in there. You just hit the keypad, hit number one,
hit number one.
And that turns it right on. Right. But I had to call Magic Jack and tell him. They said, well, that's what you do. So you listen to the message. As soon as it starts saying you can't connect, you know, unauthorized.
Press number one.
Hit number one, and it goes through every time.
Well, that's awesome. I'm going to go figure that, find that out right now.
So you can call us.
Right. No, it's always a game call. In fact, we maintain an 800 number for the bed and breakfast up there, and it points to an Alaskan number. So in the past, I'd want to use something like Skype. I would call the 800 number, and it would be an 800 call. If I want to use Magic Jack, I'd use the 800 number because I couldn't dial up there.
Yeah, now you can.
Cool. Very cool. Well, I just learned something new from Computer Club, and I hope all you learned something from Computer Club. I hope you guys come back next week. And I'm going to bring this to an end. This has been Scott Stimson and the San Carlos Computer Club coming at you from Tequila's in San Carlos, where they give us good table service, and we're still trying to sort out their internet connection. Hopefully by next week we'll have some solutions to the problems we've been having here. But thanks for joining us. If you're in San Carlos, or even if you're outside of San Carlos, if you're looking for computer help, I'd appreciate it if you get a hold of me at my business, International Computer Solutions. You can get a hold of us through our website at internationalcs.net. If you found this enjoyable, you can always check out other recordings of our meetings. I do them as a podcast on iTunes. Just search for the San Carlos Computer Club. You can also find us on Facebook. We're on Twitter. On Twitter, we're at SCC Club. If you're looking for us on the web, we've got a website, sccclub.org. So there's a bunch of different ways you can get a hold of us.
That's where you'll put that link for us too.
Yeah, I'll any of the links I mentioned today, I'll put them on the post that has the recording on sccclub.org. So it's been good, and until next Tuesday, tech on.
Did you get my email?